Hugh Glass was an American frontiersman, fur trapper, fur trader, hunter, and explorer. Born in Pennsylvania to Scotch-Irish parents, Glass went away to sea as a young man, became a ship's captain, and was then captured by pirates working for the Jean Lafitte. Given a choice between death and working for Lafitte, Glass chose piracy and sailed for a year under the skull and crossbones. After that, he and another man decided to escape off the ship. The two deserters slunk north towards St. Louis, the westernmost locus of American civilization. They took special care to avoid the Karankawa, notorious for eating settlers, but after a journey of several hundred miles ashore, they were captured by a gang of Pawnees. The Pawnees stripped and tied Glass' friend to a stake. As Glass watched, they stuck needles of pine into his friend's flesh, then lit him on fire. When it was Glass' turn, he bowed before the chief, then reached into his pocket and took out a vial of cinnabar, the flaky red mineral found in Texas and used around the world for makeup, pottery, and war paint. The chief was impressed by the gift and offered him to live with them. During his stay, as an honorary Pawnee, he learned lance throwing, tomahawk chopping, and how to break and suck the marrow of buffalo bones. It was during this period that he likely procured his legendary and beloved rifle, the mighty and thunderous 54 caliber Hawken, to which Glass grew profoundly attached and that later would cause him so much trouble. Then after that, he went to St. Louis, from where he answered an advert placed in the Missouri Republican by the Rocky Mountain Fur Company, which was seeking 100 men to pack up to head into the Rocky Mountains for hunting beavers for $200 annually. During the journey, the core of the 100 stopped to trade to a band of Ree Indians, where the Rees did not want to trade, and they killed a huge portion of the mountain men. Not to be outdone, the remaining mountain men set the Rees village on fire. Many men, women, and children died and ended up being all an out war, which Hugh found himself right in the middle of. When all said and done, Hugh survived and he and other sorry mountain men went towards Yellowstone to trap beavers. One fateful day on the journey, Hugh walked into a suspiciously cleared area which ended up being a bear's nest. He saw a grizzly bear along with his cubs. Glass shot her with his rifle and it was a good shot, but the bear kept charging. Glass ran into a tree, but as he began to climb, she grabbed him, threw him to the ground and tore some meat out of his rear. She tossed the meal to her cubs, who probably had never tasted a man before, or said they liked it. Then again returned her attention to Glass. She ranged her claws across his back, beat him about the head and shook him like a rag doll. Glass moved in close and slashed the bear repeatedly with his knife. He tried to yell, but what came out was a kind of high-pitched gargling as his throat had been torn open and was gushing blood. By the time the rest of Hugh's men got to him and were able to kill the bear, he was a mangled mess. He can't see, he can't speak, he can't move. The men did the best they could, and the assumption was he would be dead by the morning. However, Hugh made it till the morning. His group made a wooden stretcher and carried him along their journey. It slowed them down. They knew hostiles were nearby. On the fifth day or so, Henry, who was the group leader and the general, offered cash. Accounts vary between $80 and $400 to any two men who stay with Glass until he died, then meet the others at his namesake Fort Henry. One volunteer and otherwise forgettable figure was named John Fitzgerald. The other was a teenager named Bridger. They kept Glass comfortable and waited for him to die, and after 5 days, Hugh was still alive. Now they weren't alone in the mountains. The mountain men were being pursued this whole time by the Ree Indians because they burned down their village. Sensing the Rees close, Fitzgerald and Bridger took Glass' rifle, knife, tomahawk, and flint. If they showed up empty-handed, Henry would have asked where the weapons were, and they wouldn't get paid. The two men left Glass next to a nearby stream underneath a berry bush, just in case, but Hugh did not die. Shortly thereafter, Glass regained enough strength to begin the arduous journey to Fort Kiowa. Over the next 2 months, he traveled some 200 to 300 miles. During his journey, he came across a buffalo that was being worked over by the wolves. Hugh shoo the wolves away and ate the raw meat of the buffalo. Soon after, now a little stronger from the raw buffalo meat, Hugh came up an abandoned Indian village. Though it was abandoned, there were dogs, and Hugh managed to strangle one and eat. Then eventually he was able to walk. His wounds, bones and ligaments were healing. But the one thing that wasn't healing was his back, which at this point was covered in maggots living and feeding off his open wounds. Hugh came upon a party of Sioux Indians who were friendly and meant him no harm. They took him and even sewed bear skin onto his back to cover his gaping infected, maggot-infested wound and helped Hugh to Fort Kiowa, where he stayed for 2 days meeting with French fur traders before demanding to be placed on a boat to be taken upriver, still trying to hunt down the men that left him for dead. So far, Hugh had crawled, stumbled and walked his way hundreds of miles. This boat took him another 300 miles in his quest for vengeance, and it did. But when Hugh, along with the French fur traders, made it to their destinations, the place had been overtaken by the Rees, who then murdered Glass' entire company. Again, he was alone in the woods being hunted by the Indians. Just as the Rees were about to capture Hugh, a heroic group of Mandan Indians swooped in. They rescued Hugh from certain death and delivered him to safety at Fort Tilton Trading Post. At Fort Tilton, he could start and rest and take a breather, but he didn't. He did not want to rest. All he wanted to do was hunt down Fitzgerald. 6 months after he was attacked by the bear and left. 6 months after crawling down the mountain, eating raw buffalo and maggots all over his back, and 6 months of nothing but focused on getting his revenge. He found his old company in a stock, which was the new Fort Henry along the Bighorn River, but only Breezer was still at the fort. After talking to him, and since he was just a teenager, Hugh came to realize that Breezer was basically an innocent bystander in all of this, and Fitzgerald was the sole person responsible for the last 6 months of hell. Severe winter weather kept Hugh stuck there for a few months, but as soon as he could, he jumped on a boat and headed downriver on an official mission for the Fur Company to get to Fort Hawkinson, which is where Fitzgerald was said to be on. After several other struggles, he finally reached the fort. After having failed to kill Jim Breezer out of kindheartedness, he now failed to kill John Freezer for a more frustrating reason. Fort Hawkinson was a US Army outpost, and Fitzgerald was now an enlisted soldier under the protection of his commanding officer. There was no way for Glass to murder the thieving lowlife without being locked up in the fort cell for a good long time. Glass did get his old rifle back, and at least he managed to put a pistol ball through Fitzgerald's shoulder. All this suffering for none other than wounds. Hugh headed back west to live the perilous life of a mountain man.